Many items were found with Otzi the Iceman's 5,000-year-old frozen body. One of those items was a dagger. In this video, we'll show you how to make an Otzi the Iceman-style dagger. The first thing we're going to need to make our dagger is a wooden handle. The handle on Otzi's dagger was made out of ash wood. Here, I'm cutting a piece of ash wood with the copper axe while it is still green, and then shaping it using flint tools. I will then let it dry and season. The ashwood dagger handle was just under 9 centimeters long and had a groove carved in the tip of it to receive the stone blade. The back of the handle also had a notch carved around it, which helps secure a piece of grass cordage. Next, we're going to make our stone dagger blade out of a piece of flint. Begin by striking the flint core with a hammer stone to drive off large flakes. These flakes are incredibly sharp and can be made into different primitive tools, including scrapers and arrowheads. As we continue to reduce the rock, we are left with many large flakes, including this biface, which is a perfect size to make a dagger blade. The next step is to grind down any sharp edges with an abrasive rock, and then strike the edge of the piece with an antler to drive off flakes. As you continue to remove flakes, the blade will become more thin and uniform and begin to develop a center line all the way around the edge. You can then switch to a smaller antler for the finished percussion work. Once we have our piece of flint worked down to a rough biface like this one, we're ready to do the final shaping. Now, Otzi's knife blade was not very big. If it wasn't already attached to a handle, archaeologists might have classified it as an arrowhead. But because it was frozen for all those years and still attached to the handle, they knew it was a small knife blade. People often ask where I get my information on how to make these Iceman reproduction gear, and my favorite resource is a book titled The Man in the Ice. Here on page 113, it has a color photo of the dagger with its scabbard. This book is great because it gives a lot of dimensions. One of the dimensions it gives is that currently, in modern time, the knife blade is 6.4 centimeters long. So I just draw the shape and measure out 6.4 centimeters, and then I have something to go off of. Originally, they estimate this knife blade to be 7.3 centimeters long, so I'm gonna make it with the complete tip. They don't know if the tip was broken off 5,000 years ago and just something that Otzi was still using, or if it broke off in between or during recovery. Now this black part down here is the tang, which represents the part of the knife that was in the handle. So we need to make this flint blade in this shape, and then we'll insert it into the handle. We know exactly how the Iceman shaped the flint because he had this tool on him. This was laying in a similar area to where they found the dagger. It had a groove as well on the back of it, which may have had grass cordage tied around it and tied to his waist as part of his tools. And when they first found this, they didn't know what it was because they haven't found anything like this from the same era to compare it to. But after doing more research, they found out that it's a piece of lime wood, a branch, and it was hollowed out and had a piece of deer or stag antler shoved into it. The tip of the antler was blackened from being hardened, and it was wore down a lot more than what I have here. It was sticking out less. And what they've determined is that it's a flint napping tool. They call it a retoucher or a pressure flaker. I've been using this tool for flint napping and it actually works really good. You can put your thumb right there, wrap your pinky around there, and then you can just use it to apply pressure and drive off the flakes. So I'll show you that process now using a 5,000-year-old style pressure flaker to make an Otzi the Iceman style dagger blade. Before you start pressure flaking, you really want to grind the edges of your knife down to develop platforms to push flakes off of. Then use the pressure flaking tool to press in and down to release the flake. Continue this process of grinding down the edges and pushing off flakes until the blade becomes more uniform and closer to the desired shape.
Now that the blade's pretty close to where we want it, we're going to start shaping down the tang and putting in the notches for the lashing. Within a few minutes, we have the back of the blade looking like how we want it, and the overall blade starting to look pretty good. It's not flake for flake exact replica, but it's close to the size and shape of what Otzi used more than 5,000 years ago. The next step is to carve a notch in the tip of our ash handle that will fit tightly with the lower half of our stone blade.
Using stone tools definitely takes a lot longer, but it gives you a good sense for how things were done more than 5,000 years ago. Now that the stone dagger blade fits well into our wooden handle, we're ready to secure it. On Otzi's other artifacts, such as his arrows and copper axe, he used a natural glue called birch tar, but in this case he did not use any glue. Instead, he used the long, strong fibers of animal tendon. This is called sinew. Here, I'm going to use sinew from the back of an elk. To start, we need to get the sinew fibers wet and pliable. Traditionally, this was done by chewing it in your mouth. After several minutes of mixing with your saliva, the sinew becomes soft and ready to wrap around your stone blade. The sinew fibers will shrink as they dry, making an incredibly strong hafting that will hold your stone blade in place. Once the stone dagger point is secure, the final step is to wrap the back of the ash wood handle with a piece of cordage. To do this, first take some natural plant fibers and twist them using the two-ply twist method. The original length of the cordage is not known, as it was broken off sometime in the past 5,000 years. It was probably long enough to be able to be tied off on something such as his backpack or his belt to help prevent the dagger from being lost. Now we have a small dagger that's made out of the same material and is the same size as the one Otzi the Iceman used more than 5,000 years ago.
There's a few more things I wanted to talk about with Otzi's dagger, hopefully to help reduce the number of negative comments I get on this video. People are very opinionated about Otzi the Iceman and his gear, and have different beliefs about how he lived and what he did. One of those lines of thought is that some people don't think that this is a dagger at all because it had a broken tip and it was found near his fire kit of using flint and iron pyrite and some tinder fungus, that some people believe this is actually a striker for making fire. And it could be. I just feel like going all the work of making the cutting edge, it's likely a dagger for just a more of a pocket knife type, and striking it against the pyrite would really wear down the blade. That's another thing, is why is it so small? This was probably a cutting tool that was much bigger, and because he had his pressure flaker with him, as it dulled and chipped, he would just work it down. So it was probably a lot longer and then worked down to this size. Also, another comment might be, why'd you call it a knife and some places and a dagger in others? Technically, it's a dagger because it has two cutting edges. A knife is classified as having one cutting edge and a dagger as two. So I think of it more as a pocket knife, cutting grass or cutting up some meat. But because it has two cutting edges, it's called a dagger. Next to a picture of the original dagger. And this picture is actually to scale. It's the same size. And you notice a few differences. The sinew's not lashed as far down, and there's some dings in here. What that is when they found the body and tried to get it out of the ice, they used ice picks, and they were just hacking away at it. They tore apart Otzi's hip, and they actually struck the artifacts too. So an ice pick actually hit the handle and put gouges in it. And this damage here occurred when they gouged the scabbard with the ice picks too. So these things took abuse. That tip may have been broken off from the people recovering it and getting it out of the ice. And that's what it looks like now with x-rays. But this may not be the original shape. This tang may have came out a lot more because those ice picks struck directly at the handle area and may have had part of the blade extend out there and be chipped off by the people recovering it that weren't very careful with the artifacts. So this original blade may not be this shape. It may actually extend out here and have more of the tang exposed on the handle. And it's too bad that the artifacts took some abuse, but I think this is closer to what it looked like when it was in use. And then after time and a rough recovery, it looks like this. Even more impressive than this dagger blade, which is pretty simple to make for primitive technology, I had way more fun making the scabbard. This thing is made out of tree bark with grass twisted. It's a weaving technique called double plating, and I'll show you that in the next video, how they were able to weave some grass and bark into this intricate scabbard to hold the dagger. And he used leather a lot for making a belt and different things, but they did not use leather to make the scabbard to hold his dagger. They used this twisted plant fiber. So very interesting. It's amazing that it survived 5,000 years. And we'll show you how to make that in our next video.